I'm a freelance copywriter myself for almost 10 years. And as Anna mentioned, I also own and manage the freelance platform opdrachten.be in Flanders. And I'm very happy to share some of my insights, my experience on how to find and keep new clients. It's a very obvious theme, but a very important one, because simply because your clients as a freelancer are the oxygen that make you breathe as a freelancer. Just for your information, when I will be talking about writers in this presentation, I will be referring to both translators and copywriters. Everybody should feel concerned, unless I specifically mention one of those two or another writing profile. At the end of the presentation, Anna will also put in comments a small resume of the advices that I will be giving. And I hope you enjoy and some of the insights that I'm very happy to share with you. Now, before diving into the fascinating writing industry, let me just share two advices, general advices that apply to all freelancers. It's two advices that I often give when I talk to freelancers in my network. And I always tell them, when you want to find new clients, whatever your job is as a freelancer, start looking in your own network. And it sounds very obvious, but a lot of freelancers forget this. Your own network, it means your existing customers, your suppliers, your friends, your family. They are a first very good source of business. I often meet freelancers who tell me, you know what, Bavo, I'm going to start freelancing. I'm a copywriter, for example. And we are going to launch a huge campaign in the whole country to attract new clients, cold prospection. I've hired a marketeer and so on. But what they forget is that often their potential customer is much closer than they think. So that's really my first advice. Don't look too far when you start doing prospection. And a second advice that I like to give to freelancers in a very general way is make sure that you create for yourself sustainable and passive visibility. Let me explain what I mean by that. You should have your name popped up on platforms, on profiles. Social media is an excellent way of doing this. It's what I call a passive prospection that needs an active start. It is nothing as powerful as having your name in databases on platforms, which are there, and people can potentially find your name without you having to interfere. So this is a more passive way of doing prospection, but I strongly believe that it's important, especially for starting freelancer. Make sure your name and your activity are present on online or even offline. So these are two general advices that I would like to start with. Now, as I told you, I'm a copywriter myself in a Dutch language, and throughout the years I have quite some experience in copywriting business. And I've been talking to a lot of other freelance copywriters and translators as well. And maybe it's interesting, before I start giving you advice about the freelance, about finding and keeping clients in as a writer, to have a look at the difficulties that you might potentially have, the obstacles that you meet when you want to find or keep new clients as a writer. And when preparing this presentation, I was like, you know what? What are the difficulties that the freelance writers already told me about? And I've got three difficulties. The first one, and I think this is something you will all recognize, the answer to the question, what is a good text, is not a black-white answer. I often compare this with, I'm a little bit exaggerating maybe, but I'm sometimes comparing this to a freelance accountant You know, a freelance accountant, when at the end of the day, his numbers are correct and he did the correct calculations, he did a good job. But the writing industry is a much larger gray zone. So it's very difficult to convince. Well, you can think you wrote a text with a very high quality, but maybe your customer doesn't think that. And once again, I'm a little bit exaggerating maybe, but often the way your client is going to judge your text depends on what he or she had for breakfast in the morning or the way she woke up or he woke up that morning. So the quality of a text is the perception of a quality of a text is a very big gray zone. There is a very large interpretation that can be applied. Second obstacle that I often hear from freelance writers is that a text can be a translation or a copywriting a new text is often considered as a necessary evil. What do I mean by that? For example, let me give you an example. A company that wants to expand its activities to an international level, they are preparing a whole marketing strategy to do so. But you as a translator, you are actually the necessary evil because a company will never want to translate their text, but they have to. So you as a translator or as a copywriter, you are often a must-have and not a nice-to-have. And that's what I mean by that is that often you have to convince your client first to work with the copywriter or translator before even selling or convincing them about the quality of your work. And then the third one, obstacle and difficulty that I often see, and that is something you probably will recognize, is that you as a freelance writer, you often have to compete not only with colleagues, and I mean with other professional freelance copywriters or translators, but actually with anybody who can write more than two words. I'm a little bit exaggerating, but writing is sometimes considered not as a specialty job, not as an, something that you have been studied for, but somebody that happens to write often is called upon to do some copywriting. And I'm going to give you a little bit a ridiculous example, but something that really happens. It happened 2 years ago, and it's a colleague of mine who told me. There is this company here in Belgium, and they wanted to build a new website with new texts, new technology, and so on. So they have this 15 brainstorming sessions on how they want the look and feel of this website. They have a whole SEO plan that they are going to put in place. They have 16 selection rounds to select a web developer. And then suddenly, they're like, oh, damn, we need text as well to put on our website. And then they were like, oh, what are we going to do? Now, there is this intern in this company who has been working for this company for 3 weeks. And she told, during lunchtime, she told her colleagues, you know what, twice a year, I'm writing a few texts for the magazine of the local basketball team. And you can already imagine how the story ends. This poor girl, this poor intern is the one who is going to write all the texts for the websites. Now, I don't want to minimize her writing skills, but it's just to show you, this example is just to show you that often you have to compete not only with professional writers, but sometimes also with an internal solutions that companies find, which is not always the best solution. Now, that was the obstacles, the difficulties. Let's move on to the opportunities. I've got three advices to find new clients and two advices how to keep your clients. So let me start with finding new customers. The first advice I want to give you is you have to ask yourself the question, who are my customers? And this is not some kind of marketing cliche, but you really actually want to, what I want to say, my advice is that you have to decide for yourself what the answer to that question is. You need to decide as a writer, who you want to work for. You can be an excellent general copywriter, which can be work for many industries, but my concrete advice is, as a writer, and especially for copywriters, this is very interesting, try to focus on one or two specific industries. There is a friend of mine, he's a freelance copywriter, and he, a few years ago, he decided to focus and to specialize himself in the writing of job descriptions. And what is very interesting about that, it's not only he can specialize himself in the way he should write these texts, but he also created for himself a very clear target group to do prospection, which are recruitment companies, headhunters, outsourcing companies, and so on. So answer the question, who are my customers? And you are the one who decides what the answer is. Try to focus on one or two industries. Second advice that I would like to give you, it catches up with the advice I gave earlier for all freelancers, and it is make sure that your name and your activity, and for the translators, the language combination, is present in databases of companies and organizations. Writers, and I'm both copywriters and translators, they have this typical profile that companies like to keep in their database, even if they don't have a concrete job for you right now. But it's, why do they like to have you in their database on their list? Because very often, and you'll all recognize this, when you get a copywriting job or a translation job, it's a last minute job. The most heard answer that I got over the 10 years is when we were discussing deadlines, is I asked my customer, when has the job to be done? It was yesterday, always. That's the answer they give me. So what I wanted to say, often when you put yourself in the shoes of a company, they get this very urgent translation job in their company. They will, first of all, have a look on their own list, on their own database. So make sure that your name and your activity is in the database. And there is a very smooth way of, and that's especially when you want to do cold prospection, I think there is a very smooth way to approach those companies. I think there's a big difference when you ask a question, hey, my name is Bavel, I'm a copywriter, Dutch language, specialized in press releases. Can you please put me on your reserve list? Can you please put me in your database if ever you have a need for a writing job? Then calling them and saying, hey, my name is Bavel, I'm an excellent copywriter, and I would like to write all your future press releases. I'm a little bit exaggerating, but this is another way of approaching potential customers. So that was my second advice to find new clients. Make sure you are present in the databases of these companies. My third advice, and this is something that not all my colleagues agree on. And when I talk about colleagues, it's both writers and companies, potential clients. But this is my opinion and my personal experience. But please feel free to share in comments if you have some other thoughts about it. But what my experience is that sending examples of previous work can sometimes be counterproductive. What do I mean by that? I know it's a very common process in writing business and also in the creative business. Graphic designers, they do this a lot as well, is to like compose a portfolio of previous texts, previous work you have been doing for clients, and sending this to a potential client or based on a demand or by doing cold prospection and saying, you know what, this is some examples of previous work. This is the quality I can potentially deliver. It can make an impact, I absolutely agree, but I also believe that this way of approaching potential clients can have a downside. And why? When you put yourself in the shoes of this potential client, you have to know that sending examples of previous work, you're taking a risk, a much higher risk than you think. Because if there is one element in your previous work, in your texts, that this potential client doesn't like, even if you're potentially not going to apply this to this new customer, it will be much more difficult to convince your client. So there is like an intermediate solution, which I believe in, and that is, if ever you still send examples of previous work, your portfolio, don't just send a text, but send the context. Because sometimes you have to. The potential client sends you an email, says, "Hey, Bavo, I would like to work with you, but can you send me some examples of previous work?" Then, of course, I have to do it. But in that case, what I do is I send two or three texts, which I selected, and I give explanation. It can be very short, an explanation on how I wrote those texts. That means for which customer, which industry, which target group, what were the commercial goals of that client. And when your potential clients will read your portfolio and examples, you are able to give this context, and it will be they will be less quick to judge you on this previous work. So sending examples of text can have an impact, but know and be aware of the fact that it does contain a certain risk. Once again, this is my personal experience and personal opinion. I know that not all my freelance colleagues agree on this one. Now, the exciting part. Once you have convinced clients to work for you, you want more work. You want to keep this client. And that brings us to the second part of this presentation. And I've got two advices for you. First of all, you have sent a text to your client, the first version. You're hoping that your new clients will be happy with your text. And what I often see is that, especially starting freelancers who don't have a lot of experience, they do their utter best and they try to convince this new client about the quality of their work. I think you can make more impact, you can have make a better impression if you don't try to convince your new client about the quality of your work, but about the impact that the text can potentially make, the text that you wrote. And once again, this catches up with the advice I just gave you. When you send texts to your new client, explain some of the choices that you made. Say, "Hey, Clara, this is a text I've been written for you. I structured those two paragraphs in this way because I believe your target group needs to be informed first about this and then about that." And this has two advantages. First of all, your clients you can show your involvement to the client. Your clients will also, when reading this text for your first time, will also have more context, and you can actually guide your client in your writing process. I think potentially you'll have less corrections when you proceed that way. Try to convince the client about the impact that a text can potentially have rather than convincing them about the quality of your work. Let's be honest, your client doesn't care if you are the next Shakespeare. He just wants a text that suits his commercial goals, his her target group. Second advice to keep clients, you as a writer, in the first place, actually, you are just a link in the big chain. You have a graphic designer, you have a web developer, you have a printer, you have a lot of industries that come together. You're just a small link in the chain by writing a text. And the advice that I give you is show your interest in the whole process. And something that I like to do is when I write a text, I send it to a client, there are maybe a few corrections to be made, and then the client approves the final version of the text. the text will be published, can be online, offline, anywhere. And what I do is 2 or 3 weeks after the publication of the text, I call my client or I send an email. I say, hey, Clara, I just want to follow up. Did the text that I wrote for you made the desired impact? If you do that, your client will say, hey, Anna is, I'm just taking your example, Anna, because I see you on the screen. Anna is thinking about me. She is interested in the whole process. It's not just, hey, I delivered my texts, job done. And that creates an awareness to this client. He'll say, hey, this guy is open to discuss. He's concerned. He feels concerned about our target, our commercial goals. So I think that's very important. So be proactive and ask for updates on the results that your work had. I can tell you, you will be one of the few who do that. There are not a lot of writers who do that. I've hardly heard anybody do that. And you can also, you can stand out in this whole process, in this whole chain.